Shishi Mahadi's Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Ananda Koti Vaishnava Vindiki Jai, Namachari Srila Haridas Kaur Ki Jai, Prema Gahoshi Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gauradhar Shri Vasudeva Gaur Bhakti Vindiki Jai, Shri Radha Krishna Gopi Gopinashyam Mukunda Radha Kunda Giri Govardhana Ki Jai, Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai, Navadvip Dham Ki Jai, Ganga Mayi Ki Jai, Yamuna Mayi Ki Jai, Tulasi Devi Ki Jai, Bhakti Devi Ki Jai, Samveda Bhakti Vindiki Jai, Gaur Premanandi, all glory symbol devotee. All glory symbol devotees. All glory symbol devotees. All glory to Shishi, Guru, and Gauranga. Okay, so we're reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, 10th canto, chapter 8, text 8 through 9. So we'll just be reciting together text number 8. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Kamsa papa mati sakyam tavachana kandu dubi devakya ashtamo garbo nastri bhavatum arhati. Somebody could chant. Jesus.
Thank you. Padami.
Word for word. Kamsaha. King Kamsa. Papa Matihi. Very, very sinful. Having a polluted mind. Sakyam. Friendship. Tava. Your. Cha. Also. Anaka Dundubi. Of Vasudev. Devakyaha of Devaki. Ashtamagarbha. The eighth pregnancy. Na, not. Stri, a woman. Bhavitum arhati. Is possible to be. Iti, in this way. Sanchinyayan, considering. Shrutva, and hearing this news. Devakyaha, of Devaki. Darika vachaha, the message from the daughter. Api, although there was. Hanta gata, anshankaha, there is a possibility that Kamsa would take steps to kill this child. Tarhi, therefore. Tat, that. That incident. Naha, for us. Anaya bhavavet, may not be very good. Translation. Kamsa is both a great diplomat and a very sinful man. Therefore, having heard from Yogamaya, the daughter of Devaki, that the child would kill him, that the child who would kill him has already been born somewhere else, having heard that the eighth pregnancy of Devaki could not bring forth a female child, and having understood your friendship with Vasudev, Kamsa, upon hearing that the purificatory process had been performed by me, the priest of the Yadu dynasty, may certainly consider all these points and suspect that Krishna is a son of Devaki and Vasudev. Thus he might take steps to kill Krishna. That would be a catastrophe. Purport. Kamsa knew very well that Yogamaya was, after all, the maidservant of Krishna and Vishnu, and that although Yogamaya had appeared as the daughter of Devaki, she might have been forbidden to disclose this fact. Actually, this was what had happened. Gargamuni argued very soberly that his taking part in performing the purificatory or the reformatory process for Krishna would give rise to many doubts, so that Kamsa might take very severe steps to kill the child. Kamsa had already sent many demons to attempt to kill this child, but none of them had survived. If Gargamuni were to perform the purificatory process, Kamsa's suspicions would be fully confirmed, and he would take very severe steps. Gargamuni gave this warning to Nanda Maharaj. Nama Om Vishnu Badaya Krishna Bastaya Bhutale Shrimati Bhaktivedanta Swamini Tinamane Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pacharne Nirvasesa sunyavadi paskacha te shatarane. So here in the purport, various points are being made in the translation. Things are being mentioned about the purificatory process and how many demons were sent to kill Krishna. As we know, Putana was the first demon that was sent to kill Krishna. And then there was also the whirlwind demon, Trinavarta, and the cart demon. So they were all sent to kill Krishna, but Krishna killed them. Because he's all-powerful, and all these other demons, although all the demigods were afraid of these different demons, they were no match for Krishna. So here we find mentioned of the purificatory process. The soul is meant for purification. We're in this material world. We're contaminated by the three modes of material nature, goodness, passion, ignorance, and we have to become purified. So the highest purificatory process is to know the knowledge of Krishna, the Supreme Personality of God, because Krishna is the purest of the pure. Throughout our life, there's various other purificatory processes mentioned. And in the system of Varnashrama, they delineate these various samskaras or processes of purification. And without these various samskaras, society is simply a society of animals. They are not even human beings, simply two-legged animals. Just like the animals, they are simply concerned with eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. And so if the human beings, so-called human beings, simply engage in those activities, then they are regarded as no better than animals. The animal eats and sleeps, we eat and sleep. We engage in sex life, the animals engage in sex life, we defend in our own way, the animals defend in our way. And the animals take birth and the animals die. And if a human being acts like them, simply taking birth like an animal and dying like an animal, what is the difference? There is no difference. So this human form of life is meant for ultimately realizing one's real position as an eternal servant of Krishna. It's not simply to enjoy material sense gratification, to have a long duration of life. Like the Srila Prabhupada was mentioning about, like the trees, there's some trees that live for like 10,000 years. But what's the point? They have no consciousness. Their consciousness is so dull. So Prabhupada says, better to have 10 years in Krishna consciousness than 10,000 years as a tree. So this is the importance of self-realization. So these different samskaras are there so we could ultimately reach the ultimate goal of life of becoming Krishna conscious, without which everything else is simply a failure. So one may go through all the different samskaras, a purification, but if one doesn't become a devotee, then he has simply wasted his time. This is required to become a devotee of Krishna. And even such a person, if he's not a devotee of Krishna, he cannot even purify himself, what to speak of others. But somebody who is a devotee of the Lord, fixed up in Krishna consciousness, not only purifies himself, but he purifies everyone. He purifies all his family members so many generations forward, so many generations back, just by being a devotee of Krishna, regardless of his taking birth in a Brahmana family. So there's a need
in society to have a good, intelligent brahmanas to perform these various samskaras or purification. So the brahmanas are there to help people raise them up on the spiritual platform. They're there to teach them about deity worship and to understand Krishna. So there are these different paths, the paths of Pantrika Vidhi and Bhagavad Vidhi. So the Pancharatrika Vidhi is there in deity worship, worshiping the deities, and also Bhagavad Vidhi, which explains the different processes, nine processes of devotional service. So both of these are required to advance in Krishna consciousness. And so the brahmanas, they help the population in these two different aspects, by engaging them in deity worship, by performing them different samskaras under the Pancharatra Vidhi system, and to engage them in hearing about Krishna from Srimad Bhagavatam and preaching the glories of the Lord to the people of the world. So that there's a need for such good and intelligent class of Brahmins in society. In this way, society could advance spiritually and go back to home, back to Godhead. So these different samskaras are there, and if they are maintained in the family, then the family members are able to pass on this culture, this purity to their descendants, to their sons and grandsons, just like we see the example of Dhruva Maharaj. Although he was only a boy of only around 5 years old, he could not tolerate an insult to his prestige. His stepmother said that you can't sit on the lap of your father because you weren't born from my womb. So he became very upset, and he went to his mother. And his mother said, "What could I do? I'm not the favorite wife of your father. If you want to attain a great kingdom better than your father, then you should ask the Supreme Personality of Godhead." And it is said that he stays in the forest. In this way, Prahlad Maharaj went to the forest and he attained Krishna's darshan like that. So such a small boy, and still, because of the samskaras were properly performed in the family, he could not tolerate this, being insulted in this way. So these different samskaras they're performed with the chanting of Vedic hymns, chanting the names of the Lord. This is mentioned in the 17th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. It's mentioned there that there's different purificatory processes from conception till the time of death, and all these different purificatory processes, there is the chanting of Om Tat Sat, which indicates a supreme absolute truth. So this chanting of Om Tat Sat is there, and Srila Prabhupada specifically mentions that it's given at the time of it's mentioned that Om Tat Sat is mentioned at the time of initiation of giving of the sacred thread. And also Jiva Goswami explains that for the various purificatory processes, there is Sankirtan, the chanting of the holy names before the ceremony and after the ceremony. So this is the recommendation. So these different samskaras are for purification, and by these they purify us. It's mentioned in the Krishna book in the 10th canto that there's different things that purify different articles, and the samskaras purify one's birth. So by performing the samskaras, one's birth is purified. And So that the first samskara is the garbhadham samskara. So this is, Srila Prabhupada mentions that this is not a secret affair. This is not a hide and seek affair. As there's a ceremony and all the relatives are invited and the Brahmins are invited and they give their sanction. And then the couple engage in sex life to have a child, and they absorb their thoughts in the lotus feet of Krishna. In this way, good children take birth. Otherwise, if there's no garbhadham samskara in the family, then the whole family becomes sudra, like that. So this garbhadham samskara is also mentioned as giving protection to children. So in Vedic culture, there's five sections aside that were given special protection. The women, the children, the old men, the brahmanas, and the cows. So it's mentioned in the, I believe it's the first canon of Srimad Bhagavatam, that how these five things, five different sections aside are protected. It's mentioned how the children are protected by the performance of the garbhadham samskara, which is the beginning of pure life. So we can understand that if one has a garbhadham samskara performed, then one has a very good consciousness. One has an advantage. Otherwise, one will be very disturbed in one's consciousness. And also, the women would be protected in society, because when the women are protected, then there will be good population. This is mentioned in the first chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, that when there is irreligion prominent in the family, the women of the family become corrupt. And from the degradation of womanhood, O descendant of Rishni, comes unwanted progeny. So it's very important in society that the women will protect. In this way, there will be good population, which is the basic principle for peace, prosperity, and spiritual progress in life. So they were protected by the elderly members of the family. They were protected by being engaged in religious activities, and protected against freely mixing with men, and against irresponsible men who provoke adultery in society. So in this way, they were given protection in society. So, and in Kali Yuga, instead of accepting these different samskaras of purification, they simply want to engage in sense gratification. So they see that this birth, giving birth, having children, is simply a botheration. In this way, they try to check the population by various artificial means. But Srila Prabhupada mentions that it's no more feasible to check birth as it is feasible to check death in artificial ways. If you can't stop death, you cannot stop birth. And we see practically in the world that the population is simply increasing more and more, no matter what they, before it was a few, 20 years ago was like 4 billion, then 5 billion, now I think it's 7 billion. So it keeps on increasing no matter what they try to do, because people have their karma, they have to take birth, and somehow or another they'll take birth. And if we engage in sinful activities by killing children, then we simply have to suffer. So it's natural that a child feels safe on the lap of its mother, but in Kali Yuga, even the children are not protected. They're not even safe. And because of this, people have to suffer. It says if you commit abortion, then you'll be killed in the womb again and again and again. And for many years, you will not see the light of the sun or the moon. So this is the bad karma. It's equated with cow killing. Killing the child and the woman, killing cows, are equally as sinful. So this is a very demoniac situation. And, or they try to artificially stop birth by the contraceptive methods. And Prabhupada said, it was in May the 4th, 1973, he mentions, on a morning walk, he mentions how checking birth by contraceptive methods causes cancer like that. He said you could take note of this or do research on this. And also, he said in Los Angeles on a morning walk that these different venereal diseases, people engage in sinful activity, they get venereal diseases, and probably by these venereal diseases cause so many other diseases, such as cancer. So this is a result of sinful life. People engage in sinful activities, they're just increasing their suffering more and more. Where if they properly engage in religious activity, then they gradually elevate themselves and they get the opportunity, or they're able to go back to home, back to Godhead. So there's these different samskaras. There's also the marriage vivaha yagna, which is one of the acts of sacrifice, probably mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. So this vivaha yagna is meant to regulate the mind, to make it peaceful in order to advance in Krishna consciousness and spiritual life. And for most men, this vivaha yagna, this marriage ceremony, is recommended even by those in the renounced order. So this is mentioned. This is recommended. And of course, there's diksha, brahminical initiation, which is a sign of a second birth. We take birth from our mother and our father, which everybody does. Even the animals have a mother and father, but a human being, he takes second birth. And the process of taking second birth is from the spiritual master. So there's different systems. There's a Pancharatrika system, and there's a Vedic system. The Vedic system is that to become a brahmana, one has to be born from a brahmana father. Otherwise, one cannot take initiation. But the Goswamis give the Pancharikri system, which is if the spiritual master sees that one has some inclination to take up spiritual life, he fans that and brings it out, and then he gives second initiation, a brahminical initiation. Just like in the Sanatana Goswami mentions in the Hari Bhakti Vilas, that just like one takes base metal and one adds mercury to it, then one can turn it into gold. So similarly, by the process of initiation by a bona fide spiritual master, one could become golden, or one become a Brahmin. So Prabhupada's mentioning this, and that about this process of becoming a Brahmin, even from a low-class family. And he even said that, this is mentioned on the 25th of May, 1969, he mentions that we are not responsible for our birth, but we are responsible for our work. So this is a main emphasis in Krishna consciousness. We emphasize the work. Of course, it's very good that one takes birth in a Brahmana family, but that's not the main criterion. The main criterion is that you engage in the work of a Brahmana, not simply say, I'm a Brahmana, and simply do all nonsense. Just like in India, people were so caste conscious that they would not accept somebody who was born in a Sudra family, because they would consider them untouchable. Like Prabhupada mentions how, like just like in South India, the Sudras had to say when they came down the street, I'm a Sudra, I'm coming, Like close your doors like that, so they would have to say like that because they didn't. The Brahmins, so-called Brahmins, didn't want anything in their house to become contaminated. So in this way, they were looked down upon. And then later on, the Muslims, Aurangzeb, he had taxes for the Hindus. He said, if you're not a Muslim, you have to pay tax. So the Sudras thought, well, you know. The Hindus, they're not, they treat us very badly, so might as well just become a Muslim. So in this way, the Muslim population increased like anything in India. It's not that they exported or imported so many, Muslims into India, but just the people there took up that because they were rejected from Vedic civilization. But this is not the standard Vedic civilization. It's by quality. Or is by work, not simply by birth. So in Krishna consciousness, we emphasize this. So there's different qualities of a brahmana, and one of the qualities is truthfulness. So Prabhupada gives us the pastime or the history of Gautama Muni. Gautama Muni was approached by Satyakama. He wanted to become initiated by Gautama Muni, and he said, I want to become initiated by you. And Gautama Muni asked him, who's your father? And Satyakama said, I don't know who my father is. And Gautama Muni said, go ask your mother. And so he went to ask his mother, mother, who is my father? And she said, I do not know who your father is. And so he went back to Gautama Muni and he told him, I do not know who my father is. So he said, I will accept you because you're truthful, you're a Brahmin. So this is the quality of a Brahmin. Nobody would like to say that I'm a son of a prostitute, but because he was a Brahmin, an actual Brahmin, he was truthful. So this is one of the qualities of a Brahmin. He's truthful. He's very clean inside and out. As Prabhupada mentions on the audio, on the Veda basis, different audio of the Gayatri Mantra, and on there he mentions how the Brahmanas take bath at least three times a day, at least if possible three times a day, or if not, at least twice a day. So they're very clean inside and out. Even in the Vedic system, Prabhupada mentions how the Vedic system, they know how to take out their intestines and clean them and put them back again. So he says, so inside and outside, they're clean. And the Brahmanas, they're Arjavam, they have simplicity, not duplicity. They have Gyanam, Vijnanam, practical knowledge, knowledge and practical application in life. And they're Astikyam, they have belief, firm belief in the scriptures. They do not interpret the scriptures, they accept them as they are, like that. So, these Varnashram has these some samskaras, and Varnashrama by being situated by having this Varnashrama in society, society will come to the mode of goodness, will be able to reach the mode of goodness. Otherwise, being the modes of passion, ignorance, or increasing one's lust and greed, one has to remain in this material world and various species of life. But one situates oneself in the mode of goodness by establishing Varnashrama and by rising early in the morning, seeing the deity, And this way, one could be situated in the mode of goodness and not be affected by the lower modes like that. So Prabhupada mentions how we want to, he said, one of the items of this Krishna consciousness movement is to establish real varnashrama by qualification. He mentions how we should establish this in our society amongst our members, and it doesn't matter what varna you accept, as Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, by following one's quality of work, any man can be perfect. So if one can be perfect by having the occupation of sudra, one should one artificially become a Brahmin or a sannyasi and fall down? Prabhupada says this should be checked. So it's very difficult to establish varnashrama, but we have to show at least an example of how it is done, because as it is said, example is better than precept. So what we are doing now, we're doing on a small scale, but if we want to do Krishna consciousness on a small scale, then we have to introduce this varnashrama. It is possible, by it people will become happy, and it can be done perfectly, so we have to do it perfectly. And so this chanting of Hare Krishna will go on, but this varnashrama will be there to make the path easy. Because to become a Vaishnava is not such an easy thing. If it was such an easy thing, then why are so many people falling away? Why are so many people falling away? So Prabhupada mentions so many of these things about varnashrama in a conversation he gave on the 14th of February, 1977. So he mentions specifically these things, and he mentions how, I think it was Hari Sari brought this up, that it was mentioned some years ago about, you know, something about varnashrama, and Prabhupada mentioned, yes, he said, then was not the time, but now is the time you could do something. So we have the instruction of a spiritual master. We may feel that it's very difficult. When could we do this? And yes, it was difficult at one point. Prabhupada admitted that. But he, 1977, he said, now you can do this. So so we have to hear from the spiritual master and understand all these things. Just like Prabhupada mentions, he wrote a letter to Rameshwar on the 14th of February, 1973. He said, I have heard that the devotees under your care are not attending the programs. He said there should be 1 hour in the morning and 1 hour in the evening time. So we have to hear. And I remember during that time, well, Rameshwar was, the devotees were under his care was, the devotees were engaged in book distribution. So they would go out and they would spend many hours and they would come back late. But I noticed during that time that, you know, they weren't coming in the evening time, but then I noticed they started coming again. And I think it was because of this letter that Prabhupada sent to Rameshwar that they should come in the morning. All the devotees should come back for, you know, the evening class like that. And also Prabhupada wrote other letters. Another letter he wrote, he said, the new devotees should study 3 hours a day, including the classes like that. So this is very, very important. Of course, the most important thing, Prabhupada mentions that in another letter. He said, more important than knowing Krishna is applying, or more important than knowledge of Krishna is applying that knowledge or devotional service. So of course we know we have to have both things, because how do you know what to do unless you hear it? But of the two, applying that knowledge is the most important thing. So we have to apply this knowledge, and by applying that knowledge, then we'll be successful in our life, and we'll please Krishna, and we'll go back to home, back to God. And so I'll stop there. Are there any questions on these points? Yes.
Yeah, thank you, Boo. Nice class. You brought up a lot of interesting points. A couple things I just wanted to ask about. One, you made that statement. You quoted Prabhupada as having said that we're not responsible for our birth. We're responsible for our work.
Uh-huh.
I was wondering if there's maybe a little bit more to that, because that doesn't sound right to me. I mean, I always thought...
Well, that was in the 25th of May, 1969, in a Brahmin initiation lecture. And Black Prabhupada was mentioning in there that, you know, it's by quality, not it's by one's work, not by one's birth. So he was emphasizing a lot. It's not to say that, of course, we know if you engage in demoniac activities, then you take a lower birth. That's your responsibility. We understand that. But at the same time, he said that, so we have to understand both things. So, you know, the main thing is we have this opportunity to become Krishna conscious, even though we're born in very low families, most of us, or I'm born in a very low family. So, but by engaging in Krishna conscious activities, we don't have to worry about that. We just have to follow instructions of spiritual master, engage in proper activities, and then our perfection is guaranteed.
So it's kind of like, from the context, it's sort of like you're suggesting what Prabhupada meant by that is that we're not disqualified by our birth, we're disqualified by our work. And it's like somebody could be born in any kind of family, and that's not a disqualification from them having the opportunity to become Krishna conscious. But what is a disqualification is if they don't act.
Well, if he was talking to devotees in initiation lecture, so they made it to the point of accepting a spiritual master. So they're, you know, it's better, of course, we know that if you're born in a devotee family, you have a better chance of becoming Krishna conscious. But once you accept a spiritual master, then, you know, in other words, once you become initiated, then karma is like a fan, goes around, and once you become initiated, then you unplug the fan and it's slowing down, like that. So we become free in that way. So unless you plug it in again, then there's no problem. You know, you're going back to Godhead like that.
Okay. Well, second question, if there's enough time for it. You mentioned about how in the Vedic system, I think you said it was that your father has to be a Brahmin.
Yeah, your father has to be a Brahmin. So that's only Brahmins. You had to be born of a Brahmin family to become initiated.
Well, like you always ask, where is that stated? You always ask when you ask questions. I was just curious, is that stated someplace? Because I can't
remember. Oh, it's stated throughout Prabhupada's books, you know.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so many places. You know, I got a reference in here, but it's so many times as mentioned. This the type of system we have, the Panchakrit Vidhi system. That's according to, even though you're born in a low family, you can become initiated. Even though you could become a Brahmin.
So is Panchakrit Vidhi something that's been newly introduced?
Of mentioned like that, but it's been going. I mean, it's mentioned by the Goswamis, and. You know, new, I mean, that's...
Systems exist simultaneously since time immemorial, that if you were born in a Brahmin family, you became a Brahmin, but simultaneously this is...
Anyway, it probably says it's a Vedic system. The Vedic system is, I can't I can't really say, you know, I mean, okay. If it's new, but there's two systems, you know, like that.
All right, thank you.
Okay. Anybody else has any questions at these points?
Hari Om.
Yeah, yes,
Prabhu? Just very simply, you said Brahmana means, which Prabhupada mentioned, to be clean externally and internally.
Yeah.
So externally is by taking bath, as you mentioned. But Prabhupada said internally means by chanting Hare Krishna. It means the consciousness.
Yeah, he mentions
not,
that.
Not because you mentioned internally as if it was, you know, you mentioned the intestines or something.
Yeah, but he mentions both things. So he mentions, usually he mentions externally bath, of course, internally chanting Hare Krishna. But he also mentions internally the intestines. He said the Vedic systems, they clean the intestines. And there's more, and there's other quotes I got. He mentioned in other ways, keeping the intestines clean and not clogged up. You know, he mentions you're not clean if your intestines are clogged up. He mentions like that also. So, you know.
I would favor that that's part of the external.
Well, Prabhupada mentions it part of the internal. He does.
Okay, mostly. And during,
yeah, usually.
During Brahminical initiations is when he mentioned that internally means chanting Hare Krishna.
Yeah, internally, but he also, but anyway, he mentions externally bath and internally chanting Hare Krishna, which he usually states, but sometimes he also mentions internally as the intestines being clean. It's a part of internal cleanliness. You could say it's like a material, an internal material cleanliness in that aspect, whereas internally chanting Hare Krishna, it's based on the soul or like that.
Consciousness.
Yeah. Consciousness, yeah. Right. But this, you could say there's internal material, there's external material cleanliness and internal material cleanliness, whereas chanting Hare Krishna is internal spiritual cleanliness, like that. Okay, so we better stop there. All glories to Shri Guru and Gauranga. Mm-hmm.